Hello everyone, we are live again, and today we have with us Dr. Anand Mamdapur, who is the Senior Consultant in HOD at the Critical Care Medicine Department at Sakra World Hospital. Welcome, sir.
Thank you.
So we had asked you guys to drop in questions with related to critical care and an ICU setup in a hospital, and we have received overwhelming response. Thank you so much, guys. So we'll start, sir, with the questions.
Sure.
Right. So the first question which was asked to us was, what kind of conditions are usually chosen for an ICU admission?
Okay. So any patient who is unwell, who is sick, who has an issue with any organ, for example, he may be having a lung infection, what is called as pneumonia. He may be having a weak lung, difficult in breathing. He may be having a brain infection, acute stroke, brain hemorrhage. Any patient of any sickness which is unwell from any organ per se can come to the ICU. Nowadays, we are getting a lot of poisoning also coming to the ICU. Snake bite can come to the ICU. Any major surgery, after the major surgery, including like a liver transplant, kidney transplant, major surgeries, they come to the ICU for observation as well as monitoring. Nowadays, there's a lot of trend of increased trend in young youth people about alcoholism. Lot of alcohol related problems, they do also come to the ICU. Abdominal issues like liver failure, any patients have a kidney problem who needs an emergency dialysis, all these patients do come to the ICU. So you name an organ and that organ is unwell, that patient will come to the ICU.
So basically an entire spectrum of a human body falls under the purview of critical care medicine.
Yes.
Right. So now the next question is, so now these kind of people, what's the duration of stay for such people when they come?
Right. It basically depends on the type of the problem and the nature of the problem they come with. It can vary from a simple one day to couple of days, couple of weeks and few months also. For example, a patient might have come with a very low blood sugar, or a patient might have come with just one episode of fits. Those people will stay just for one day. In contrast to other patients who routinely stay with us for about 3 to 4 days, routinely, that's a routine thing. People also have a very long duration of stay. For example, they come with a complicated infection, wherein it affects multiple organs, they end up in multiple organ failures, and they require dialysis, they require ventilators. Such patients will have an extended period of stay. And also patients who come with predominantly a brain problem, like a brain stroke, massive brain stroke, or patients who come with muscle weakness like problem, for example, we call it myasthenia or a GB syndrome, who have predominantly muscle weakness, or patients who come with a paralysis, they stay for a very, very, very long time.
What's the most difficult scenario in an ICU setup?
In contrast to the routine thing, what you are asking is the most difficult problem we face in the patient. Managing any complicated patient is relatively easy for us because we are experts in that. But managing the family, the relatives, is the most challenging part, because for most of the families, this comes as an unexpected, unanticipated problem. Many of them are not at all prepared, and the person who is getting admitted may be the breadwinner for the entire family. There'll be a lot of psychological issues, social issues, financial stress, because ICU treatment is a bit expensive, quite expensive. So managing the family is one of the most difficult challenge in the present day ICU. We have a lot of empathy, we take care of them, a lot of sympathy. We counsel them in detail about the problem, make them understand what is the problem, how best we can go about it. On a daily basis, we'll tell them what is the present situation, what is the proposed plan, and what is the likely outcome. In many of the families, some of them are doctors also. So we speak to them and make them understand what is the problem with this patient, so that the trust development is very, very important. The trust factor, the moment you achieve the trust factor, then things can be very, very easy. So for me, managing the family is the most difficult thing in the ICU, and we take care of them while they're in the ICU.
Right, sir. What's the recovery process outside a ICU setup? Because they stay here for few days, months, depending upon what they're actually suffering with.
Yeah.
But then outside the ICU setup, where they're not under a clinical diagnosis or a clinical surveillance, what's the process?
So usually most of the recovery, near recovery, happens in the ICU. After that, they go to the ward for the remaining recovery. Usually it is a matter of only few days they stay in the wards and they can go home. But in predominantly other situations, like what I mentioned, like neurology problem, muscle weakness problem, these are the people who stay for a very long time. or people who had a very complicated course, like we had recently one dengue complicated situation wherein they stayed for a very, very long time. So it depends on the primary problem again. And it is also possible that, you know, patients who come with a minor problem, they get directly discharged from the ICU to the home. It's not necessary that they ought to go to the ward. So it is very much possible, but basically it depends on the primary problem.
Yeah. Right. Now, this is one of the very interesting questions which was asked. What are the quality standards one should actually look upon before choosing that, okay, I should be looking at XYZ hospital over ABC hospital?
Right. So every good ICU will have good amount of quality indicators, what you call as quality indicators. So there are different varieties of quality indicators. For example, the survival rate in the ICU, the death rate in the ICU, that is a very, very important quality indicator. The infection rates in the ICU, because we use a lot of medications, we use a lot of injections. For that, we need to give a lot of medications through the special lines, special tubes. The infection of these special lines and special tubes is a very, very important quality indicator. So we take utmost care, what you call, we always wash our hands before touching the patient, after touching the patient. This is a very, very quality indicator. So infection related quality indicators are very, very important, and they are the backbone. And there are also other quality indicators, because for us, patient safety is very, very important. There is always a risk of fall of the patient. He can fall from the bed and he can cause injuries. It can cause injuries. So fall risk is an important quality indicator. And many a times the patients remain in the ICU for a very long time. They are in the bed for a long time. They are at risk of developing pressure sores. It's an important quality indicator. And as a medical profession, we are at the risk of getting an injury while doing a procedure, what you call as needle stick injury. So these are all the quality indicators. So these are all various quality indicators based on which an ICU is decided as a good ICU or it needs to improve.
Now, these indicators what you mentioned, are these open for people to view? Say somebody walks into the OPD.
Yes, absolutely. They are very much available in the ICU. Anybody can come, and it's a transparent unit. You can go through the data.
Right. We have heard about ICU transfers.
Okay.
What's that?
ICU transfers can be of two types, within the hospital or outside the hospital. For example, any patient in the ICU, he can go to the operation theater for the transfer, or he can go to a CT scan, or he can go to an MRI. So for which a transfer is important. We always make sure that, as I mentioned, patient safety is very, very important to us. We always make sure one of our doctors and a nursing staff does accompany the patient to any procedure in this. Or sometimes the ICU transfer can be due to other reasons also, and they are going to other hospital or they are taking to native place. So this is called outside the hospital transfer.
Okay. What care can the patient's family provide when the patient is admitted in the ICU? So now we are talking about the role of the patient's family.
Okay. The patient's family, most important is the psychological support is very, very important from the patient's family to the patient. I know they are in a lot of distress, a lot of frustration, a lot of psychological stress, financial stress. But even then, we request them to forcibly bring a smile when they are next to the patient. And when they are discussing with us, yes, they can definitely address all their concerns. We are happy to address all the concerns, and we are here to help them. But when they are with the patient, they have to motivate them. Yes, you are doing well, you're improving well. Very soon you'll be out of the ICU. Very soon you'll be out of the hospital. So they have to give a lot of positive vibes, positive energy to the patient. And patient himself has to be very positive to come out of the problem. It applies to everything. Okay.
Right.
So positivity of a patient, positivity of the patient family, and the trust factor is very, very important for a successful outcome in the ICU, other than the routine medical care.
Right. Now this brings us to our next question. So this is, how does a usual day look in an ICU setup for you?
Okay. My ICU day starts from the time I start my car. So while driving to the hospital, I make a plan for all my patients while I'm driving. For all the patients, what is the tentative plan based on what I have seen yesterday and based on what inputs I got in the previous night. So I make a tentative plan and then enter in the ICU. Then we take a detailed rounds of the ICU with all our colleagues, nursing staff, and also we take a lot of inputs from the previous day night doctors. Then we assess the patient from top to toe. We'll do bedside examination. Of late, we are doing a lot of bedside, what is called as ultrasound scan and bedside echo only. that gives us a lot of information and helps us in a very quick decision-making process. And sometimes we also take the inputs from other cross-specialty consultants, specialties also, so that we make a concrete plan for the patient and execute on that.
Right.
And after that, the most important thing is we sit for an indefinite amount of time with the patient's family for the counseling. So we'll tell them about the developments in the last 24 hours, what are the positive developments, what are the negative developments, and what is the plan for today, and what is the likely scenario, what we anticipate, what is the likely plan, and how to go about it. So we discuss in detail with them, and we'll make them comfortable with a lot of empathy, and make them understand the disease process.
Right. The common belief is that ICUs are scary, and for extremely critical care situations, as a result, many people panic.
Yes, ICU is certainly scary. Even for me also, it's scary because, you know, I have a lot of sick patients in the ICU and I get a call in the night, then I'm scared. I pray God that this should not be a bad call. It should not bring me a bad news. So ICUs are certainly scary because it not only with respect to the medical problem, the severity of the magnitude of the medical problem, as I told you, it imposes a lot of psychological and financial stress in the family. And the family is extremely stressful and they are very delicate in that moment, and we have to handle them with a lot of care. So it is definitely scary. And we always suggest patient family members that not to panic if you get a call from the hospital, because it is not necessarily a bad news. Sometimes a call can be simply because of an insurance purpose, or it can be from the administrative purpose. So unless they hear completely from us, no need to panic if you get a call from the hospital, because that is the time they are in extremely vulnerable phase psychologically.
Okay. Is it possible for a patient to be admitted in an ICU setup for a month or even beyond?
Yes, it is very much possible. Especially as I mentioned, patients with having a brain problem, major brain injuries or major strokes, and patients who are having muscle weakness, as I mentioned, this is what you call as in medical terminology, myasthenia patient, and GB syndrome patients, patients who have had an injury in the spine wherein their all four limbs, like both hands and both legs, are extremely weak, they're not able to move. All such patients end up in the ICU for a very, very, very long time. They are prone for recurrent problems, one after the other, adding to the frustration of the family, as well as adding to the hospital stay, cost and everything. And some diseases like pancreatitis, like acute pancreatitis, if it goes for a severity of the problem and gets complicated, those patients stay for weeks together and months together in the ICU. Though it is less common, but it is very much possible.
It's possible.
Yeah.
There is a common notion among the common people that once a patient is under ICU or is on ventilators, they are considered non-recoverable. So what's your take on that?
It is a common myth among all the population, including the top educated families also, that a patient is on a ventilator means it is in his final journey. No, that is not the case. Ventilators are the life-saving machines. They are also part of the treatment for the patient. It is not the ventilator which decides that the patient is almost in the near final journey. It is the primary problem, the severity of the problem, and that problem makes the patient to land up in the ventilator, not the ventilator per se. Okay, there are a lot of diseases which recover, a lot of patients we do day in, day out. For example, a patient has come with a bad lung infection, patient has come with a snake bite wherein all the muscles are paralyzed. There are so many diseases wherein the ventilator acts as a life-saving measure, and it helps the patient and it gives rest during the period of stress so that the patient can come out successfully. And there are certain indications wherein we only do not suggest the patient to go for the ventilator. For example, a patient is having an advanced cancer. This cancer has spread everywhere to the almost entire body. Then that patient comes with a problem. They have a difficulty in breathing. Then we only suggest the family not to go for a ventilator, because it is the primary disease. Malignancy has spread. The cancer has spread everywhere. It is not going to recover. So in this situation, putting a patient on a ventilator is not right. So we only suggest. But ventilators are the final journey path. It is totally incorrect. Right. And ventilators are life-saving. Just like it is an angioplasty is a life-saving in a heart attack, ventilators are life-saving whenever there's a problem, not only in the lung, in the whole body.
Right.
Because all our organs, though, are separate, brain is separate, lung is separate, heart is separate, they function in coordination with that. A patient who's having a severe brain problem, he will require a ventilator. Though his lungs must be absolutely fine, but because the brain is a very important center that controls our breathing process, he needs a ventilator support. Okay. So in that context, ventilators are life-saving and they do not kill any patients.
So it's absolutely a myth that they are non-recoverable.
Absolutely.
And
absolutely.
Right. So we have received another question. Which infections to watch out for in an ICU setup?
Yeah. In the ICU setup, three important infections are very common. One is a urine infection. One is a lung infection. Sometimes bed sore infection can also possible. So these are the infections which can happen within the ICU while the patient is being treated. So these are very common infections, especially urine and lung. And as I mentioned, we do a lot of lines and procedures and tubes. Those procedures and lines and tubes related infections are also quite common.
Okay.
So we always look into these infections on a daily basis. Are they developing? And we take all the precautionary measures to reduce the rate of that infection.
Okay. Another question which just came is, how is a neonatal ICU different from a regular ICU?
Neonatal ICU is a totally different specialty on its own. What we deal here is, in our specialty, my specialty is an adult ICU. All, you know, people above the age of 14 years we deal with. Neonatal ICU is a specialty of its own and it is still intricate, it is still delicate.
Okay. Right. Another question just came and it's about what are the chances of getting staph infection in an ICU setup?
Yeah.
So people who are in the care of the patient, not just medically, but other care staffs.
Yes. All the medical people, whether it is a doctor or a staff or a technician or a radiographer, all of us are at a high risk of developing infections. And infections which happen in the ICU are a difficult infection to treat. And when we go home, we always take bath and we always are scared that these infections should not, you know, we should not transmit to especially the extremes of age, kids and parents, elderly at the patient, because these infections are quite difficult. Yes, we are prone, however, we deal in day in and out, and but we, at the back of our mind, we are always worried that we are definitely at the risk of, one, getting all this infection, and also injuries, as I mentioned, that we can get a prick from an infected patient, so that infection can get transmitted to all of us. Yes, we are at risk.
Everybody is at risk. Yeah. So now, coming back to our hospital, Sakra World Hospital. Yeah. So why would you say that our hospital is well equipped and has all the quality standards that, yes, one should consider Sakra World Hospital for critical care management?
Yes. So ours is a tertiary care hospital wherein we have all high-end gadgets and facilities and we have highly trained doctors, and probably this is one of the few hospitals which has got highly trained doctors even in the night also.
Right.
You know, even in the night also we have got highly trained doctors coming from reputed institutions. They are working with us and we give an utmost good quality of care, and we have got an excellent communication rapport with all of our colleagues. And the moment we want something, it is done in few minutes, sometimes in few seconds also we can do it. So all emergencies are taken care with utmost care in rapid succession. You name something, it is done immediately. So, and we take care of patient safety. As I mentioned, patient safety is one of our very important goal and target, and we take utmost care of that. So I prefer, if I am to the patient, I would like to come to my ICU.
Perfect. So viewers, this brings us toward the end of this closure of this session. I hope we have answered all your questions. If you have any further question, you can drop it in the comment section and we'll respond to those. Thank you so much for joining us for this session, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.